Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in the fabulous state of South Carolina. Hope you guys are doing all right. I've been busy. I have lots of videos that the Lord gave me, as I always do. Praise God for that. You know, there's nothing greater than the Lord inspiring you. You know, the word inspired, like inspiration to breathe. That's why they call it in the Bible, says the word of God is God-breathed. You know, and that's why the real name for the Holy Spirit in the Bible in Hebrew is the Ruach Elohim, the breath of God. Praise God. In the New Testament, the word is pneumo, like a, you know, your pneumonia, pneumo, meaning breath also. So the Holy Spirit is the breath, the very breath of God. God breathed on us, brothers and sisters. And that's one of the videos that the Lord gave me I want to talk to you about. And, you know, sometimes I do these videos and in the past, if you've been following my channel where I get into all this esoteric stuff, like when I was on the radio show before, a couple of times I talked about dualities and all that. And this is what I want to tie into that. I want to talk about what God did with Adam. Now, I just want to run through some Bible verses. Now, if you look at Luke, the gospel according to St. Luke, I believe I'm along in there in chapter 2. It gives the genealogy, maybe it's even chapter 3, the genealogy of Jesus Christ. Now, Matthew gives it in chapter 1, starting from Abraham and going down 42 generations until the Lord Jesus Christ. But in Luke, it goes backwards. You know, it starts out by saying Jesus, you know, it was supposed was the son of Joseph, and it goes on backwards. And then it says who were the son of so-and-so, the son of, like, you know, Isaac, the son of Abraham, on and on back. Then when it gets to Adam, you know, it kind of blows you away because, you know, the genealogy is kind of boring to sit there and read it and read it. But when you get to the end, it says, "And Adam, who was the son of God." Okay, so what does that mean? And if you start looking at the Bible, and, you know, and the Lord was just speaking to me about this the other day, because there are people that talk about in the Old Testament, you know, in the Old Testament, it talks about sons of God. It's talking about angels. In the New Testament, sons of God is, when all the references to sons of God in the New Testament, we're talking about really the church, born-again Christians. And, of course, Jesus is the only begotten, the monogenes, it says there in the Greek, in Revelation, or in John chapter 3. It says that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. In King James, in the original, in the Greek, it's saying the monogenes, which is a one-of-a-kind. You know, a unique one of a kind, mono meaning one, genesis of one origin, you know, one individual origin, the only begotten of the Father. So, you know, when I've done teachings and you've heard teachings, you know, that the Lord had showed me, and then when I started, you know, making videos and I started researching, I found out there's other people that the Lord had spoken to also several years, of course, before me, but I got my own independent revelation from the Lord about the Nephilim and all that. And the understanding that, like, they built the pyramids or they oversaw the building of these monolithic structures and all that. And I made videos about that way back when I first started. You know, the rise of the New World Order. And that was what my channel was really all about when I started, as the Lord led me, was all this revelation that most people never talk about or never heard, that, hey, you know, the clash of the titans and all that stuff is real. And then there are people, brothers and sisters, the truth is because theological seminaries don't know what to do with the ideas of giants and all that. They just X out all of that explains why God sent the flood, explains why the children of Israel killed the Anakim, which is the Anunnaki, and the plural is Anakim, killed them, their children, and all of this. And you know, an atheist would say, well, God is evil because he told them to kill all these people. Why would I want to follow a God who told them to kill all the, even the women and children and all this, and even the animals? It's because they had a contaminated bloodline. This is all through the Bible. I made many videos about this. Okay, so the confusion is these false teachings from these theological seminaries because they can't handle the fact that there's really giants with six fingers and six toes, as the Bible says, and two rows of teeth. All these things are in the Bible, all through the Bible. And I made videos about that, so I don't want to get into that. But I want to touch on the fact that the argument they make is sons of God refers to angels in the Old Testament. That's true, but as you read the New Testament, as what I'm going to talk about, sons of God refers to men who become born again. And it refers to, of course, the Lord Jesus Christ is the only begotten, and then we are adopted sons of God by faith, as the Bible tells us. So what I'm trying to talk about here in the Old Testament is we see that angels, why are angels called the sons of God? Now, this is something I never thought about, but, you know, the Lord just dropped it on me like he does. He'll drop these things on me. They're called sons of God because God breathed into them. You know, angels don't have parents, just like Adam didn't have a mother and a father. God individually made each angel and breathed into them. That's why they're called sons of God, because they're, you know, they were created by God directly, brothers and sisters. Now, you and I, lots of people talk about, you know, God created me and all this stuff. God did not create us directly, brothers and sisters. He created Adam directly, and that's why Adam is called the son of God. And then Adam, through the process that God made, you know, sexual relations between males and females, as it says in Genesis, even animals, mammals, and even fish and all this other stuff, except for, you know, you're talking about amoebas or something. But all the animal kingdom, they create after their own kind. A male and a female come together, they crossbreed, you know, half of the DNA from the man, half of the DNA from the female and the male. And then they produce offspring. So therefore that offspring, even though God created them, but directly, God did not create. God directly created all the first animals and Adam and all and Eve and all those things that God did. But we as descendants, we are sons of Adam. You know, Jesus Christ himself was called himself the Son of Man, which he was. He was born of a human, of Mary, who was the daughter of a mother and a father. You know, Mary had a father, who had a father, all the way back to Adam, just like everybody else. But Jesus was the Son of Man, but yet he had no earthly father, and therefore he's also the Son of God. You know, directly created by, you know, the body, as the Old Testament, you know, quotes about Jesus, it says, you know, a body you have created for me. You know, so Jesus had a body that was created, you know, the Holy Spirit overshadowed Mary, and then, you know, God, you know, literally created the body that the Lord Jesus Christ entered for him. But the rest of us, we are the product of, you know, indirectly created by God. So therefore, when we're born in this world, the Bible says that we're lost and without hope in this world, strangers and enemies of God because of our sin, our fallen nature. So that's why it tells us, brothers and sisters, in the New Testament, John chapter 1, it says, to as many who believe on Jesus, who believe on his name, to them Jesus gave power to become the sons of God. John chapter 1. Now, the interesting thing and the reason why I started looking at all this is because the Lord was telling me about the angels. You know, why are they called sons of God? Because he literally directly created each one of them. They don't have parents like we do, you know, and that's one of those old questions, you know, one of those conundrums. Did Adam and Eve have belly buttons? Well, they weren't. They didn't have an umbilical cord, so they probably didn't have belly buttons. So that's something different about them also. Anyway, brothers and sisters, it says, Paul's talking about the rapture, and that's, of course, the overall theme of the messages that I always give from the Lord is prepare for the imminent return of the Lord for his church and prepare for the, you know, the end times for those who are not truly born again, prepare to enter the tribulation, prepare to refuse to take the mark, prepare to be a tribulation saint so that you can enter the kingdom of heaven and not be cast into hell. So Paul tells us something interesting too. The other thing that the Lord, you know, quickened me about, Paul says, you know, that the whole creation is in travail that the sons of God would be revealed. Now let me lay out, the Lord has reminded, all the things the Lord has told me. When someone gets truly born again, brothers and sisters, their spirit is resurrected. The last video I made is kind of connected to this too. When you get saved, you become spiritually resurrected. But physically, you know, unless you tell someone, and someone can tell by your fruits or by your confession, oh, you know, this guy's confessing he's a follower of Jesus. This guy has changed. You know, look at his fruit. He's bearing the fruit and keeping with repentance, as John the Baptist said. Because the Jewish people asked John, you know, that he said, prepare the way of the Lord, repent. And they said, what should we do? And he said, bear fruit in keeping with repentance. Okay, so we bear fruit in keeping with repentance. You know, and then we have the fruit of the Spirit, which is love, joy, peace. There's nine of them there, the fruit of the Spirit, Galatians chapter 5, 22 and 23. So we bear the fruit of the Spirit, patience, love, temperance, which is self-control, all these different kinds of things. You know, and then there's also the fruit of like the works that you do for the Lord. The Bible says we are not saved by our good works, but we're saved unto do good works. Ephesians chapter 2. Anyhow, so, but we are spiritually resurrected. As Jesus said, the kingdom of heaven is within you. The kingdom of heaven is within you. So that's why Paul is saying that the creation, we're talking about in the natural world, not in the spirit, but in the natural world, the earth is in travail. That's why there's all these earthquakes and you know, in diverse places, that the earth is literally, as Jesus said, and Paul also talked about what I'm talking about here, that the earth is in travail. The earthquakes is as if the earth is in labor to bring forth the sons of God, and of course to bring forth the redemption of mankind and the restoration of all things back to like the Garden of Eden. Like back when Adam and Eve were the son and daughter of God and there's no sin and all those things. That's what we're going back to. Going back to walking with God in the garden. You know, the Bible begins, you know, in the beginning of Genesis, here we see Adam and Eve walking in the garden with God. And then in the end, we'll be walking in the garden with God. I mean, that's what God's doing. That's why it's called history, his story. God's story of redemption. From Genesis to Revelation, it goes in a complete circle, brothers and sisters. And so that's why it says, Paul says that the whole creation is in travail, that the sons of God would be revealed. Now, how will we be revealed? By the resurrection, to wit, as it says in the King James, to wit, the redemption of our bodies. Right now, we're walking around in an earthen vessel. You know, Paul, in the word there and really in the original, is like a jar of clay, like the singing Christian singing group, jars of clay. I mean, that's what the Bible's talking about. We're an earthen vessel, a jar of clay. That's what Adam means, red earth man. You know, in those old clay jars that you see from the ancient world, it's like red looking. That's what Adam means, red earth man. You know, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, that's what it's talking about. We are made of dirt. That's why in the Bible when it says when we're repenting, and we're coming to God, we should remind him, the Bible tells us. Remember, O Lord, that our frame is weak and that we're made of dust. And that's what we are made out of. We were made from dust. God took the dirt of the earth and formed it into Adam, and then he breathed the Ruach Elohim, the breath of God in him. That's why Adam became a living being. That's why he's called the Son of God. That's why the angels are sons of God. They were created by God directly. And when you got saved, if you've been born again, that's why people say, you know, like I've mentioned all the time, these Protestant preachers going around like John, I mentioned John MacArthur because he's the most famous one, going around saying that don't rely on experience, but just rely on your head knowledge and Bible verses. You can't be born again without the, can you imagine, you don't think it's an experience when the Holy Spirit breathes? When God breathes his spirit of life into your spirit and your spirit becomes a living being. You know, we were the Bible says we were dead in our trespasses. Trespasses against what? Trespasses against the law. The law is the standard that brings us to the knowledge of sin and death. And Paul said, when I sinned, then I died. We are dead to God, the Bible tells us. If you're not born again, you are an enemy of God, the Bible says. You are strangers and aliens to God. That's what the Bible says, brothers and sisters. That's why you don't hear, that's why people aren't getting saved hardly anymore in America. Because they're not hearing the gospel. It's like this, brothers and sisters. Before someone can hear the good news of the gospel, they have to hear the bad news first. You know, they have to find out, hey, I'm lost. They have to have a revelation from the Spirit of God of conviction of sin and conviction that they are an enemy of God. So all of the, even Christians, I see people writing, oh, we're all children of God. That's not what the Bible says. It says to those who believe on his name, to those who are born again and believe in Jesus, John chapter 1, even to them that believe on his name, to them he, Jesus, gave the power to become children of God. When you get saved, you become a child of God and you become spiritually resurrected, but you're still physically dead. That's why we, if you're really a Christian, like they say, we're a dead man walking, like that movie, Dead Man Walking, or what they say like in these movies about death row, it's a dead man walking. It's not I who lives, but Christ that lives in me. Amen. I'm dead to this world. That's what water baptism is all about. It's not about a ceremony. It's not about, oh, I got my ticket punched. It says that we're buried with Christ and then we're resurrected with him. And I said this all the time. I'll say it again. It's not. There's a song that they play it like on these churches, like I saw on TV. It's, you know, there's room at the cross for you. No, we don't need room at the cross. There's room on the cross with Jesus. Since the Bible says we're crucified with him. With him. We're crucified with him. Our flesh, our sin, our sicknesses, our diseases, our infirmities are on the cross with Christ. Hallelujah. We've been buried with him and also resurrected. Hallelujah. You think Jesus was just babbling? Jesus wasn't speaking the very words and truth of God? Jesus, in John chapter 12, before he went into the Last Supper, as I mentioned in the last video, I'm touching back on the last video I made 3 or 4 days ago. See how the Lord works. I'm just picking up where I left off. It says that the Greeks came to see Jesus, and that's when he groaned in his spirit, and the thunder came from heaven saying, you know, I've glorified it, I'll glorify it again. God will glorify his name, glorify it again. It says, Jesus said this. He said, except a kernel of wheat fall to the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it falls to the ground and dies, it bears fruit, 30, 60, 100-fold. That's what Jesus did. God buried his son. He planted Yeshua, HaMashiach, on the cross, and then in the tomb. Jesus was buried in the tomb. That's what Jesus is talking about. The same thing is true with us. What are we talking about? I'm just talking about in this video about bearing fruit. How can you bear fruit if you're not planted, if you're not dead, if you're not buried? If I had one piece of grain of wheat in my hand and just looked at it, that grain of wheat is just a grain of wheat, one grain of wheat. But if I take that grain of wheat and put it in the ground, then it grows a wheat that has like a, you know, 30, 60, or 100 little other new pieces of wheat. Only, you know, that defies what evolution teaches. It defies, you know, the first law of thermodynamics, entropy, which says that things go, if you take a piece of metal, it turns into rust and breaks down and turns back to dust. When someone dies, you bury them in the ground in the flesh, then they turn to dust again. But God and his power of his creation to prove there's a God, you take one apple seed and plant it in the ground, you can grow an apple tree that can produce thousands of apples over 30, 40, 50 years that would produce thousands and thousands, 100,000 seeds from one seed. Imagine that. And that's what it means to be a Christian. If you are there and you're not buried, if your flesh is not dead and you're walking around in your flesh and you're not crucifying your flesh and burying your flesh, you cannot bear fruit, brothers and sisters. That's what the Lord is talking about. Not only what he did, but we can do in him. John chapter 15, he said, I am the vine, the true vine. You are the branches. You know, abide in me. No one can do any works without me. Apart from me, you can do nothing, Jesus said. The Father is the husbandman or the farmer in modern language. He prunes each vine. He prunes the branches of the vine. Anyone that doesn't abide in Christ is cut down and thrown into the fire. John chapter 15, that goes right back to what we said of what John the Baptist said. Bear fruit in keeping with repentance. Brothers and sisters, God is looking for us to bear fruit in his holy name. Bear fruit, but before you can bear fruit, you must be planted. You must be buried. You must be dead to the things of this world. Brothers and sisters, in all things, you can talk about even finances. It's true, brothers and sisters. Everything, God operates in the same way of seed time and harvest in all things. Everything we do, you reap what you sow. If you sow to the wind, you reap a whirlwind, the Bible says. If you sow to the flesh, you reap corruption. Sow to the Spirit and reap of the Spirit. Store up your treasures in heaven and not on earth. With the same measure you measure, it'll be measured back to you. You know? If you sow sparingly, you will reap sparingly in all things, in all things, in all things, brothers and sisters. Love and joy, anything you give, you sacrifice your time, energy, and all your resources to serve the Lord and serve his people, God will heap rewards back to you in all things too. That's how it works. That's the kingdom of God and how it operates, brothers and sisters. That's how God operates in everything that he does. You give, 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 and then you receive, you receive. As Jesus said, in good measure, pressed down and running over, will men give into your bosom. With the same measure you measure, it'll be measured back to you. The same amount you give, it'll be given back to you. 30, 60, 100 fold. Everything works in the same system that God created, brothers and sisters. This is the way God's kingdom operates. There's no two ways about it. There's no, all these lawyers and, like, just who is my neighbor? All this self-justification, making excuses, why you don't serve God, why God's will is not being done in your life. It's all about sacrifice. It's all about dying. It's about crucifying the flesh, brothers and sisters, to give it up all things and follow Christ. As Jesus told the rich young ruler, that young man's God was money. What did Jesus say to that rich young man? He said, give away everything you got to the poor and follow me. And the guy went away sad. He couldn't give up his God, his idol. So I say to you, what is an idol in your life? That's a whole other message and a whole, specifically talking about it. People have idols in their life, whether it be their spouse or their children or money or their car or their job or whatever it is. Themselves. Most people, it's themselves are their own idol. Throw it all away, as Paul said. I count it all as loss for the sake of serving the Lord Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul was a double PhD. He was on his way to be, the head of the Sanhedrin and all that. He was well ahead of his peers as a Pharisee, trained at the feet of Gamaliel, which was the most famous rabbi in the Pharisee branch of Judaism in centuries. And he gave it all up. Paul said, I count it all as lost for the sake of the Lord. Hallelujah. Brothers and sisters, would you die to the Lord today? Would you give up all of these worldly things, all of these things of the flesh, that you might become a son of God or a daughter of God, to be a child of God, not only in the spirit, but in the flesh, that the Son of God would reveal himself through you, that God would manifest you as a child of God at the resurrection, at the rapture. That's what we're talking about, keeping our eyes on the prize, which is when we see him, we will be like him, John tells us in 1 John. To be caught up with him to meet the Lord in the air. Don't believe all of the greasy gray stuff you've heard. That you can say a prayer when you're 8 years old, live like hell all your life and go to heaven. Live like the devil and be with God. It doesn't work like that. God said, whatever you sow, you'll reap. Sow to the wind, reap a whirlwind. Sow to the flesh and reap corruption. God says in his word that without holiness, no man will see God. Who shall ascend to the mountain of God except for him with clean hands and a pure heart? Psalm 24. Brothers and sisters, may God be with you today. May you surrender your life, your heart, your everything, your time, your treasure, your cares, your ambitions. May you surrender all of those things to Jesus Christ today. I pray you do that, that you truly decide to follow Jesus, that the world would be behind you and the Lord would be before you, that you would surrender all to Jesus. Hallelujah. Like the song says, I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus, I surrender all to him. I freely give. I freely give. I got free will. Hallelujah. I freely give it all to the Lord. The Lord will give you back 100-fold. But first, you got to let go. You got to let go of the things of this world. And God will bless you, brothers and sisters. I got to give my testimony more thoroughly. I've given bits and pieces here and there. God will make a way for you. God made a way for me. He made a way for millions of people. He made a way for the apostles. He'll make a way for you. God will make a way where there seems to be no way. But you've got to let go of the things of this world. You've got to surrender all. You've got to be buried with Christ. You've got to be dead with Christ in order to become a son of God. You've got to give it up. You've got to give it up. You've got to give it up. Give up the things of this world. You got to lay down your life with Christ on the cross. Brothers and sisters, that is what the gospel says. That is the gospel message. To follow Jesus. He said, in Luke, he says, he who does not take up his cross daily and follow me is not worthy of me. He says daily in Luke, take up your cross daily and follow me. Any man who puts his hand to the plow and turns back is not worthy of me. That's what Jesus said when he saw his disciples. Follow me, follow me. Christian means follower of Jesus. It's not saying a prayer, living your own way. It's doing the will of Christ in your life. Amen, brothers and sisters. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The world behind me, the Lord before me. The world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the Lord before me. No turning back. No turning back. Don't turn back like the wife of Lot did. She turned to a pillar of salt. Brothers and sisters, there's nothing that's in the Word of God that doesn't have a meaning and a reason why the Lord gave it to us. Don't look back. Don't look back. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. You know, I think it says, and the things of this world will grow strangely dim in the light of His glorious grace. You know, I heard someone say that the meaning of the word grace, the acronym GRACE, is God's righteousness at Christ's expense. GRACE. God's righteousness at Christ's expense. And that's the truth, brothers and sisters. Jesus paid it all. Now all to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. You know, the Lord has washed us white as snow when we repent, confess His name, call upon His name. Praise be God, Most High, Creator of heaven and earth, brothers and sisters. For God has given us all things. God freely gives us all things, just like in the garden. You know, He gives us all things. He just says, hey, don't do this, and I give you the kingdom. There's never been a better deal than what God offers us. Grace and repentance through the blood of Yeshua. There's never been a better deal on the face of this earth. It's the only deal that's too good to be true, but it is. The only deal that's too good to be true that it is. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. God bless you guys. Love you. See you later.